call to a sister in her east. Try to give remedy as usual. You're about to be tuning into Tazadaq live session.
Hello.
Hey, shalom, shalom. It's Tazadaq. It's Tazadaq. I'm not sure who Tariq is, but this is Tazadaq.
Oh, you know what? I probably wasn't pronouncing it right. This is Tanya Jefferson. You see my email?
Oh, yeah. I just sent you an email, like, probably 5 minutes ago telling you that I'll call you a little earlier. I know initially I had said, like, 5:45, but I had a little extra time.
Yeah. I needed to make sure that you was a legit person, because you know how it is on the internet when you're just talking to people. So I did have a few questions to ask you, simple questions, you know, because I talk to a lot of people, and you just get so much different information. And I was listening to you, and I said, hey, he sounds like he knows what he's talking about, but let me call him. Okay, I'm trying to get my UCC one, okay? I'm trying to get my UCC one. I'm in real estate. Some things that I would like to do, you know, I'm having an issue with my father in a nursing home. He's in what you call, I'm not sure if you understand how Medicaid works, Medicaid pending. They saying his income is too much. They're trying to, you know, look at his income. He only making $1,740 to doc. So to me, that's not a lot of income. So I got him in a nursing home where he's paying out of pocket until he's fully under Medicaid. So I'm just trying to do something to get myself out the system so I can better to help with some of this stuff that I see going on with the federal government. They charge $365 a day for a nursing home. Government gives them $1,500 per person, and they share a room with each other. Plus, Medicaid charges them $10,000 a month to be on Medicaid. That's a lot of money to be, you know what I'm saying?
So, $10,000 a month?
I investigated all this because, you know, I was sitting here like, you know, why are y'all charging so much money? And y'all, when I say $10,000, that's how much Medicaid charges per person in a nursing home. They all got different income, and they all being charged $10,000. They all get, plus they get the $1,500 a month from the government for each person, and that's not including the other perks that they get. I'm telling you. So, with all that said and done, yet, when you go to a black nursing home, it's dilapidated, it's not well taken care of, but they get millions of dollars. Can you help me understand how is it that the government got all this money for a nursing home, and yet the people are living this, it's this horrible, tall smelling, you know, they got nurses and stuff that they pay, that they don't get clean. And so I just happened to, because of what happened to my father, I had to put him in a nursing home because he needed around the clock care. And they're upset with me because I'm asking questions that people don't normally ask. I wanted to know what the bill is and how much it is and why we have to pay this out of pocket. So why doesn't he have a private room then? If he's making more money than the next person, everybody, so you're taking his whole income and he gets $50 a month. I'm telling you, it's a racket. It's a big racket in the nursing home facility.
So yeah, if I could just interject for a second. Would you say your name was again, sister?
Tanya.
All right. So you work in real estate.
I work in real estate. I do property management. I do real estate. I work with my girlfriend, has a FedEx. She's a FedEx contractor. She owns 6 trucks at FedEx. So I'm her business contact. So I work with her at FedEx. So that's what I'm doing full time, and then I have my real estate. Okay, FedEx is doing some things right now, renegotiating people's contracts, and basically it's like a battle. So within 90 days, we just plan on getting out. I just want to go and do my real estate full time. I don't want to work. I'm working 12 to 16 hours a day with FedEx 6 days a week. It's like a slave job. And I'm like, we're not doing this. This has been a year, almost a year working with her with these six routes, and I just can't do it no more. So, you know, I see all these other things going on with the government, things going down a pipe, so I just need to set up myself to have my own businesses that can help, you know, people like elderly. I mean, I can, you know, I can buy houses, put four elderly people in there, you know what I mean, hire somebody to take care of them and get the same government funds that they're giving to these nursing homes, but now I'm going to take care of them. They're going to be well taken care of, they're going to have a clean room, they're going to have decent food. You see what I'm saying? It's like, you know, I'm just sitting back watching all this happen and just accepting things as it is, you know, and that's why I'm there all the time, because they're not going to treat my father any kind of way, you know. The room going to be clean, he could have some clean linen, and it's a lot of people that don't have parents coming there, so they're going to treat them any type of way they want. So, yeah, I'm in real estate, and that's what I want to do full time.
All right.
My real estate.
Yeah, I would just you know, like to throw this out there to you. You know, if you go into real estate, that's great. But once you get into real estate, I pray that you don't be one of those people. Because a lot of the people that's into real estate, they actually set the clients up to actually be foreclosed on. Now, the reason I'm saying that is I understand the big picture and how this thing really works. Like, so the realtor goes off and they sell the property to someone. And pretty much when that person signs this mortgage deed or deed of trust, which they really don't have them sign, they have them sign a clause stating that if you don't make X amount of payments, then we could actually foreclose on you. That's what the supposed lender is actually telling the person that's actually signing for a house or trying to pay off a house. But unbeknownst to them, that their signature is actually creating their own loan. And the person that's actually signing for the loan is essentially the lender also. So, you know, I don't know that many people in real estate really understands this, but the bankers understand this. The people that's actually giving the loans and so on and so forth. So, you know, hopefully, you know, when you do go into real...
Let me tell you what I'm going through, Teddy. I've been doing this for a while now before I learned about how this whole system works. And I already have friends and family members who have lost their homes to foreclosure. So let me tell you what I'm going to full time is doing this under the CCI. I'm not going under as a broker. I'm going under as my own business.
Okay.
Because now Tanya is going to purchase the house. Tanya's not charging interest on the property. Tanya's going to give a person with bad credit an opportunity to purchase the house. I don't care what your credit look like, you put a down payment on it, and something that you can afford to pay. Let's look at the numbers. Okay, these are the houses I have. Based on the numbers, here's one of the houses I have that's in your price range, $120,000. You only can afford, in order for you to be able to live and pay all your bills, you only can pay $700 a month. My properties don't come with interest rates, it's just $700 a month. You know, you can take the time to get your credit repaired or do what you have to do. If I had somebody I can reform to help them with their credit, I can do that. You know what I mean?
Refer
to you or somebody else. And then we give you 2-3 years that you can go ahead and purchase the house for exactly what we agreed that you were going to pay for. So with 120, that's what you're going to pay minus what you already put towards it, because that's how it's supposed to be.
Right.
You know what I mean? You're never supposed to be charging people interest on a property,
right,
especially if you're already getting a monthly payment. They're responsible for the house. It's treatment just like it's your house. So you're just paying down on your mortgage until you can afford to go ahead and get the full amount that you owe me, if it be $80,000 or $50,000 or whatever. So basically, I'm my own bank. You see what I'm saying, Tazadaq? I don't want to deal with the government. You're dealing directly with me. Tanya don't foreclose on you, because basically You just have to come, if you lose a job or something, you just have to come and say, look, this is where we're at, because now I can work with you. I do understand circumstances, but it has to be a circumstances where something like you lost a job or something dramatic. Not that you're just leaving and you just decide, you know, so like paying rent, don't want to get a job. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So it's got to be something reasonable. I do understand. I see it all the time. You know what I mean? I've seen it. I've been in real estate for a long time, and I understand now. You know, I got a house. I understand now when we sign the documents. We don't fully read them. I'm a realtor. You know, we basically go on a trust thing. That doesn't happen in reality. We basically start our life over when we sign them documents.
Right.
So I understand. So basically, I'm doing this to help folks, not to put them in foreclosure.
Right. Well, yeah, that's beautiful. So, you know, as far as the other things that you was actually addressing, I'll give you my perspective on how I would handle that. Like, I can't offer you any kind of legal advice. If you need any kind of legal advice, you got to seek counsel. So, right. So now I notice you're saying UCC-1. Now I'm gonna assume that you're meaning the full secured party creditor process, because just filing a UCC-1 only puts a lien against your debtor or your straw man. So along with that, there's other documents that needs to be actually put on the public record, so certain other entities are essentially put on notice. Along with that, when I done that process, there was a power of attorney, there was a whole harmless agreement, there was a copyright. There was a few tax forms and so on and so forth. So it just wasn't a UCC-1. The UCC-1 was the paperwork that I first had to actually file to get a filing number. And then I put my other documents on record and sent them off to specific locations. So essentially, yes, the UCC-1 would be the first thing that I would do. And the reason that I filed a UCC-1 was to take control of the debtor's property, because essentially, your name, when you receive something in the mail, let's just, same thing, if they have you sign in for a home, or if they have you sign in for any type of loan, essentially, the property belongs to the debtor, which is looked at as a corporation. Because a corporation could only interact or interface with another corporation. So if you're getting a loan or something from some bank, Tazadaq, the man, wouldn't be getting it. It would be actually Tazadaq, the corporation. So the way that they make me the man responsible for that is by creating joinder, by me agreeing or consenting to some name being me or some ID card being me. And once I agree to that, they create what is known as joinder, and then I'm actually held accountable for this alleged debt.
Okay.
Yeah. So, really, it would be your corporation interacting with the other corporations, like the banks or the realty corporation or whatever other corporation. But the way that we control that is that we become the authorized representative of the corporation. And in layman's term, you would essentially be looking at yourself as if you was an attorney. Say, for instance, if you hire an attorney when you go into a court, or if you're doing a civil case or something, the attorney will speak for you. The attorney may draft up documents for you, but the attorney won't go to jail for you. So this is what you're doing. You're becoming the authorized representative or the agent for your corporation. The same thing that an attorney's pretty much doing. And that's the only reason that we're actually putting documents on, a public record, because we're allowing them to know that our status has changed. Because right now, currently, I don't know if you know the whole birth certificate jargon, but with the birth certificate, we pretty much lost the authority over ourselves, which is really jurisdiction. So now the de facto state, and what you're referring to as government, I don't even refer to it as government anymore. I refer to it as a de facto. And a de facto is something that resembles something that is not. just like the law system. It's not really law. It's color law. It resembles law. It looks like something that is really not. But they've altered everything and they've changed everything. So when you refer to government, pretty much you're really referring to the District of Columbia when you refer to the federal government. And all of the states now has pretty much become franchisees of the District of Columbia. Because when they initially, set up this form of government, every state had its own constitution. So therefore, the federal government really couldn't intervene. But when the states became incorporated, when they incorporated through the District of Columbia, now the District of Columbia really has authority and the state really doesn't have authority anymore because they got certain benefits from the federal government, just like people. So when we go and ask for benefits, and this is why you got to be careful if you go and ask for certain benefits, from the government, because if you accept a governmental benefit, then you're actually giving them the right to be able to tell you what to do and what not to do. Those are the consequences of accepting benefits.
Okay, so let me understand this, So I'm just going to take the UCC-1 tape, okay? So, all right, so now, basically what you're saying is, not just doing the UCC-1, I need to create a trust, correct?
Well, I mean, I guess you could look at it as a trust, but essentially what you're really doing is you're changing your status from that of a debtor to a creditor. Like, debtors always owe something or they always pay. Creditors are the one that's actually essentially doing the lending or they're controlling things. It's the creditor. For instance, Walmart is a creditor. It's a corporation. It controls debtors. When people want something from Walmart, they go into Walmart and they become consumers. They buy something because Walmart is the creditor. Same thing with a bank. People go into a bank and they think that the bank is loaning them something, but banks can't loan out other people's money. Okay. It's just like a facade.
Control everything, own nothing. Is that what you're saying?
Well, no. Yeah, I mean, pretty much. Yeah, I mean, we really don't own something because the real me, like the real you, is the living soul. It's not like, the physical body. The real you is the you that's actually dwelling within you. It's your soul. It's your spirit. So, the body is just a temporary temple, a temple. Like, even with death, I will actually still exist, in just a different form. So this is, and these are the semantics that they play when we go into like callable court. They'll ask us, are you Tazadaq? And if I say yes, then I just agreed to be in the fiction when they wasn't even like really interacting with me. But once they create joinder, once they get me to admit that, hey, well, that's me, even if it's really not, then I'm susceptible because I'm consenting. But, I say, no, I'm here to hear that issue and so on and so forth. I never create joinder with them. But when you keep saying Tyreek, it's making me think of Taj Tyreek Bay, but it's Tazadaq. But I accept. Tazadaq. You know what? If you can't say Tazadaq, you can say Zadok. You can say Zadok, right? Zadok. Zadok was a priest in the Bible.
I got it. I'm going to say it. Tazadaq. I'm going to get that. I'd like to get your name right.
I mean, Zadok is the same thing. Tazadaq is just in the Lashawam HaKadosh. In the Bible, if you read it, it just says Zadok. It was just a priest under Solomon and King David.
Okay. Yeah. Tazadaq. Okay. All right. I'm not an expert on this. I just went through the webinar like everybody else. So I I wanted somebody who actually knew what they were doing to go ahead and do my UCC one for me and my husband. Also, you know, everybody's telling me the create a code trust. Do you know how to do that too, Tazadaq? Do you know how to create a trust?
Yeah, I mean that's what you're really doing when you become a creditor. It's a trust between you and the debtor. It's really a trust. But now with the UCC one, I can't do it for you. I could actually show you how mine was done, because if I did it for you, then you know I could actually be accused of actually.
No. That's all I needed somebody to just walk me through it. I understand that you should know it. Because I wanted to understand what I was doing. But the other thing I was going to say was, when I was talking about a trust, they were telling me I needed to create a trust, and I had to put my house up under the trust. Is that correct?
Well, when you become a secured party creditor, what you're talking about is a secured party creditor. And a UCC-1, again, is part of that process. But you would actually list all of your personal property on what is known as a security agreement. So if you had children, you would list them on the security agreement. If you had a car, you would list that on a security agreement. And the reason being is because you was referenced that security agreement on your UCC-1, and then you have a lien against all of your property. So, you know, since you would actually be the first one that has a lien against the property, no one would actually have more of a right to the property than you, because you have a lien against it.
Okay. So now all my kids are 18 or older. They're all grown.
So now they're responsible for their own shortcomings in own life, because they've reached the legal age of majority. And most states is 18, and some is 16, and some is 19. But now, probably they're going to just go out into the world, and they're going to pretty much give themselves back over to the system. Unfortunately, that's how it works.
No, actually, my daughter is waiting for me. She's like, Mom, do yours, and then help me understand. And I have her looking at different tapes. Because you sent me a thing, Tazadaq, that said, Tony, send me my first, middle, and last name.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that was because when you said the UCC-1, I automatically, you know, went on the presumption that she's talking about the entire secured party creditor process, which you're referring to as a trust, because that is actually what's needed to, you know, draft up the documentation. It's not going to just be a UCC-1. It should be a UCC-1, a UCC addendum, and a power of attorney, whole harmless agreement, copyright, Form 56s. There's a lot of documents involved there.
Oh, good. I didn't even know that.
Yeah.
Because I have a girlfriend that's going through another mentor, and she's doing her UCC-1, and she ain't even mentioned the rest of this stuff you're mentioning.
That's because, if I could just interject, that's because a lot of people that's doing this is scam artists, and many, I hate to say it, they're not really knowledgeable on what they're doing. Some people go to the internet, they copy things, download it, and they sell it to other people, but they're not really knowledgeable on what they're doing. And then you would never guess how many people has actually went to other people, and then they come to me when things are all screwed up, and they want me to fix that. Or some people have actually paid other people, and they've gotten nothing in return. So you got to be very careful. You're doing the right thing when you try and screen people from the internet.
Okay, so yeah, because I told my girlfriend, I said, girl, you've been jumping on the first. I know we've been all listening to the same tape. I said, but I'm pretty much listening to that guy, and I wasn't feeling him. You know what I mean? So I started listening to other tapes, and then I listened to your tape. I said, so far, he got the most knowledge. So I said, let me just email him, because I don't know if he does this or not. So, yes, Tazadaq, I want his son. I need to know from me. Now, I'm going to tell you that I got your name right, not
Tazadaq. Tazadaq.
Tazadaq.
Oh, you could just say Taz. You could just say Taz. T-A-Z. Taz. You know, it's real simple.
Tazadaq. Okay. Okay, Tazadaq. to the National Security Treasurer, put my birth certificate in there. I had two birth certificates, and it came up with an amount. Basically, I was reading up on that. Tell me if I'm wrong. Basically, it's a bond, a secure bond. It's
right.
Time mature because I'm 52 years old.
Right.
And basically, and I was trying to tell other people, I tell people this, like I tell you, look, I read up on it. So basically, you cannot cash it out. It's a bond. It's a secure bond.
Right.
And basically, it gives it back to you as a bond, meaning it's like a secure credit card.
That's right. That's right. But the problem with that, another thing I warn you with, there's a lot of people out there that's telling people that they can cash it out if they become executor of their estate. And every person that I've seen try to do that, they end up with feds on them. In fact, I know some people that's doing fed time for trying to do that. So you got to be very, very careful on who you listen to.
They're not making stuff that simple. So that's why I said I need to talk to somebody who has knowledge. That is only supposed to be used to pay off your debt.
Right.
Is that correct? You should be using
That's correct. That is correct. That is correct. And that's in accordance with HJR, House Joint Resolution 192 under Franklin Delano Roosevelt and Public Law 7310. That's what gives you the ability to be able to set off and discharge debts. It says it in their own document.
Okay. See, I'm learning, but I'm just not 100% sure if what I'm learning is the right thing. Now, for instance, Tazadaq, I'm going to be honest with you. I have two judgments on my credit report. I have credit. So once I do this, I can discharge them against that secured bond. Is that correct?
Yeah, if you do it correctly, that should be really easy to get rid of.
Okay. So that's what I'm trying to do. I'm talking to these other folks who have just turned them off because their attitude is, oh, no, you can use the money to do this and that. I say, y'all going to have to leave. I'm telling you, I don't think it's done like that. And so they're doing their own thing. So that's why I just said, I want to make sure I'm learning this correctly because I do not have any leisure to be screwing up.
Right.
You know, okay, so basically, now that I had established, I feel confident in you. I have a good vibe. I feel confident. I prayed about it. I said, God, just send me somebody that has the knowledge that's going to do right. You know what I mean? So that would be you. So now, with doing my S, my UCC, whatever, on how to file all this paperwork, how do we go about doing that?
Well, I mean, pretty much, you just simply go back and read the email that I sent you earlier this morning, and, as you see, I was requesting your first, middle, last name, address, and, if possible, a P.O. box or an address for the debtor. And then, you know, it usually takes about 1.5 weeks or so to, you know, get it completed and mailed off to you with the instructions or examples on how I did it. But I'll say this to you. They will try to deter you. Even, you know, some people now, I know that Sean filed UCC-1. A lot of the UCC divisions are, like, writing them back and saying we don't have to accept this. So I would not be deterred by something like that. One must keep in mind, your only responsibility is to make a public record. If your documents is on a public record, you've done your job. And this is why I sent all of mine certified mail. Because now I have a record of the documents that I put on the public record. And they can't say I didn't do it.
Okay, now, Tazadaq, you said I need to create a post office box?
A what?
I'm saying...
Over time, because I've been doing this for a while, if you look back at some of my videos, you'll see some of them was done in like 2010. And I was doing them before that, but YouTube kept deleting my accounts. I was doing this since like 2007, but YouTube kept deleting my accounts. So, you know, I waited a few years, then when I started creating them again in 2011. So if you look back, you'll see that I was doing this for a while. But one of the things that I've learned is that it works better when I use one address for the debtor, you know, which is the straw man, and then another domicile for me, the living soul. I get better results when I use that method. So what I tell people is that I went out and I got a P.O. box for the debtor, and then as far as the creditor, I use my domicile, where I might be from time to time, because a real man or real woman do not have an address. Because if you say that you have an address, then you're giving them jurisdiction over you. There's a lot to be learned in this. So you got to be real careful with your choice of words.
Okay, so now, I'll create a post office box. Will I do that under my DNS,
yeah,
corporation that I incorporated?
Right. I mean, you're just getting a secondary address. Or, unless you already have one, you know, I will use that. Okay, I mean, and that's what I would actually use for me, the creditor. But, there will actually be instructions covering all of this. But, I mean, we've been on for like 30, 32 minutes. So, I mean, all of this... all of this would be actually answered in the instructions. Not only will there be, like, type instructions, that would actually be an instructional DVD. Well, the packet is so simplistic that if you follow the instructions, then probably, someone in middle school would be able to do this. If you just follow the instructions. Now, if someone needs additional coaching, if they need more of my time and they can't just simply follow the instructions, then yeah, I'm going to require a donation for additional coaching. But the instructions are so clear and precise that it's pretty simple and straightforward.
Okay, because, I know y'all say that, but some of them other videos that I listen to, they not straightforward.
Yeah, and that ends up coming back to haunt people when they're not straightforward. That usually comes back to haunt them in a bad way. Well, pretty much, I am actually.